This particular topic belongs to unit 4 of this particular course, analog MOS circuit design. In fact, in the last two units, in the last few classes, we have talked about the single stage and the multi-stage MOS amplifier and the differential amplifier in particular. Now, while discussing the single stage amplifier and even with cascode and differential amplifier, we have seen lots of applications of current sources. So in fact, we can always regard a current source like this, as you know, if I just symbolically want to represent a current source. So let this current source be represented by ISS. So that is the magnitude of the current source. And ideally, you know, the corresponding output impedance of the current source is pretty large. And ideally, it can be infinite. But practically speaking, the value of ISS, I mean, the value of the output resistance of this particular current source is large. It's very large. And we have already seen that this particular current source can also be represented by means of MOS device. So whenever we do have a NMOS or PMOS, in particular, so let me consider an NMOS device with three terminal, gate, drain, and source. Now, if I operate this MOS device in saturation region, then you understand that if I just neglect the effect of the channel length modulation, then the current is essentially constant in the saturation region. So in order to use the MOS device as a current source, we have to operate the MOS device in the saturation region. And there are different aspects associated with the current source. One is obviously the magnitude of the current source, that is ISS. Second one is the output impedance that is being provided by the current source. So you always want that the output impedance should be very large as possible. And the current source should be, I mean, the value should be stable. It should not fluctuate with the other parameters. And the second one is the volt, and the third one is the voltage headroom. That means whenever we are representing the current source by means of a MOS device, then the corresponding voltage headroom should not be very large, so that the available voltage swing can be made as high as possible. So these are the different aspects. One is the magnitude of the current source. Second one is the output impedance of the current source, and obviously the voltage headroom. And we always want that the current source should be stable. I mean, the value of this particular current source, the magnitude, it should be stable. Now, whenever we are going to represent the current source by means of a MOS device, and you know, the drain current of the MOS can be represented like in the saturation region, half mu n Cox times W by L into gate to source voltage minus threshold voltage whole square, VGS minus VTH whole square. If I just, for the timing, if I just neglect the channel length modulation. So that is the expression half mu n Cox W by L into VGS minus VTH whole square. Now, first of all, you have to, so far we were happy with this particular expression on the current source, or rather ID. Now you have to identify the different parameters on which the ID can vary. First of all, it depends upon the Cox. So Cox is a technology parameter. So from technology to technology, the Cox may vary. And mu n, which is nothing but the mobility of the electron, it's a strong function of temperature, as you know. Moreover, the threshold voltage is also a function of temperature. And sometimes the gate to source voltage that we're talking about, gate to source voltage can be regarded as a function of the drain supply, VDD. So we can always regard this VGS as a function of VDD. So ultimately, what we find, and apart from that, we do have this W by L ratio, which we can control to some extent, because this is the parameter which we can control during the fabrication process. But once the device is fabricated, then whenever you are operating the device under different temperature, then obviously you don't have any control over this mu n and VTH. And sometimes the supply voltage may also vary. And accordingly, this overdrive might also vary. So that is fine with any MOS device. But whenever we are using the MOS device as an ideal current source, So our notion is that the corresponding magnitude of the current source should not vary with other parameters. It should not vary with temperature. It should not vary from wafer to wafer. Even if we change the wafer from this wafer to that wafer, the threshold voltage might vary. But we always expect that the corresponding current source should provide a constant value. So that's why a notion of current mirror takes place in analog circuit. So what do you mean by current mirror? So as you understand, what is the meaning of mirror? So mirror gives you some reflection. So if you have some mirror and if you have some object in front of the mirror, then at the back of the mirror, you'll be getting some reflection, just like the actual object. So here, what we are going to reflect, we are going to reflect the current, or rather current source, I should say. So our entire discussion of this particular unit on current mirror is based on the assumption that initially we do have a reference current source. So we start with this assumption that we do have a reference current source, I reference. And right now I'm not considering the design of the circuit, which will give you some constant current source, that is I reference. Remember that we do have this reference current source, and we are just copying this reference current source in some other parts of the circuit using some MOS circuits. So there should be some copying circuit. So if I just, for the time being, let me just represent this copying circuit by means of a black box. And gradually we'll see that how this black box is populated. So let me just call this is a copying circuit. And it can provide, suppose this the output of the copying circuit is being fed to the input of a MOS as a gate to source voltage. And as you know, the MOS is a voltage control device. So now the current I out, which is the drain current of this particular MOS, can be written as a function of I difference. It might be called I difference, or it's a function of I difference. So depending upon the value of I difference, and depending upon the other parameters associated with this MOS and with this copying circuit, so I out can be related to I reference. And if we follow certain conditions, then I out can be made equal to I reference. Now the same copying circuit might be used several times in the whole arrangement. If I just consider a complicated circuit, so I always expect that this I reference, or a factor of this I reference, let me call alpha times I reference, is to be present in other parts of the circuit. Now, as long as this I reference is constant, if I just assume that this I reference is constant, somehow we are able to generate this ideal current source, this I reference, then just by using the concept of current mirror, we can just replicate this I difference. So although I'm saying it's a function of I difference, but let me make it very clear that we want that the corresponding drain current passing through our MOS device, we want that this current must be equal to I difference. So how to copy this current from one circuit to another circuit? So this I difference is flowing through this particular circuit, and I want that this I reference must be flowing through the other parts of the circuit, and there should not be any fluctuations. That is very important. It should not vary with temperature. It should not vary with the device. Should not vary with the technology dependent parameters. That means it should be independent of this mu n. It should be independent of Cox, and obviously it should be independent of, right now I'm just neglecting the channel and modulation. So it should be independent of this overdrive voltage. The only thing which we can control is this I reference as a function of, or rather I out as a function of I reference. And obviously, you know, this W by L ratio might be there in the expression. And if we follow certain equations, or if we follow certain conditions, then you can verify that this I out can be made equal to I reference. So that is the basic notion of a current mirror, that we have some reference current source, and we would like to replicate that current source in different parts of the circuit. Obviously, here our objective is to employ the MOS device as an element of the copying circuit. Now, as you know, for a MOS device, if I just call the drain currents, so drain current ID is a function of gate to source voltage. So in one word, I can write that the drain current varies with the gate to source voltage. So this function can be anything. So as long as the device operates in the saturation region, so this will be the function. And if you are more accurate, then obviously you should add another term. You should multiply another term, which is nothing but the 1 plus lambda VDS. So right now I'm just considering this particular simplified model, and later on I'll be also considering the channel length modulation or the impact of the channel length modulation. So since ID is equal to F of VGS, so we can write the gate to source voltage as simply the inverse function of ID. So suppose this ID, or let me call this VGS corresponding to this copying circuit. So then for this copying circuit, we can write this gate to source voltage can be written like as inverse function of say I reference. If I call that I reference is the drain current that is flowing through the circuit. Then if you just apply the same gate to source voltage to the other MOS, suppose this is the voltage, gate to source voltage, and I am just applying this gate to source voltage to another MOS. Let me call this MOS as M1. Now if I apply the same gate to source voltage over here, then for M1, if I write I out, so once again this I out can be written as function of the gate to source voltage. So although I'm writing like a simple function f, but you will gradually see that these two f might not be the same. The f corresponding to this copying circuit and the f corresponding to that copying circuit might not be the same. But to start with, let me assume that these are identical in nature, so the same f is applicable. And then you can easily verify that since VGS can be written like F inverse of IDF, then ultimately it will give you I out is equal to IDF. So that is a basic mathematical observation to start with. But gradually you'll see that there are certain modification which we must perform in order to have the current source properly, in order to define the current source properly. So in fact, this voltage between these two terminal is nothing but F inverse I reference. So although this particular explanation is pretty simple or pretty simple in nature, but gradually we'll show that what are the different implications that we must take into account. So to start with, let me just explore the copying circuit by means of a MOS device. And let me use the MOS device in the saturation region just by connecting its gate terminal and the drain terminal together. It's a diode connected fashion. Suppose this is a part of the copying circuit. So well, let me call this as I reference. And this gate to source voltage, suppose this is provided to another MOS, second MOS device. So I don't know what about this terminal. So this terminal can be connected to anywhere, but I want that this current I out. So let me complete the circuit itself. So I always want that this I out must be equal to I reference or as a function of I reference. So if I call the different MOS, if I call this as M1 and this as M2, then the voltage that you are applying over here, this gate to source voltage. So if I just call once again, this voltage is nothing but F inverse of I reference. But as I've already told you, these two F might not be the same. Where is the difference? Because you know, even for these two MOS, even for these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are sharing the common gate to source potential. And if, even if I assume that they are having the same threshold voltage, but remember that the W by L ratio of these two MOS devices might not be the same. So therefore, although I'm saying like F and F inverse, but it can be like F1 and F2. So for the first MOS or for the first MOS which belongs to the coupling circuit, it can be like F1 inverse. And for the second MOS, it could be like F2 inverse or F2. So therefore, depending upon the W by L ratio, these things are different. But one thing is very clear, that the both of them are sharing the same gate to source voltage. So if I just write down the expression for I reference, so I can easily write I reference is equal to half mu n cox W by L1, that means W by L ratio of the first MOS, multiplied with VGS1 minus VTH1 whole square. Once again, I'm just neglecting the channel length modulation. And for the second MOS, I mean M2, it is like I out, that is equal to half mu n cox. I'm assuming that they are having a different W by L ratio, so it should be like W by L2. And I should write VGS2 minus VTH2 whole square. Now, with the assumption that both of them are having same threshold voltage, VTH1 is equal to VTH2, which might not be true always. And one thing is clear, that the gate to source voltage being the same because they are sharing the common gate. So then we can write I reference upon I out is equal to simply W by L 1 upon W by L 2. So from that, you can write I out, the current that we are going to copy is I ref, and the current which we have copied is I out. So ultimately what we have copied into this circuit, so I out can be written like W by L 2 upon W by L 1 multiplied with I ref. So now if you make like W by L 2 and W by L 1, if these two ratio are same, I mean both of them are having same W by L ratio, then obviously I out is equal to I ref. So now you are able to copy the same current from this circuit to that circuit, from this MOS to that MOS. So then you can say that, okay, my job is over and I'm able to copy the circuit. So it can act as a mirror circuit, a current mirror. But the thing is not that simple. So we have made so many assumptions. So let me start with the first assumption. What is the first assumption? We have assumed that, obviously, you know, since you are using the MOS as a current source, so obviously you are working in the saturation region, and that is the expression, but this is not the full expression. You have just neglected the channel length modulation. But whenever we are talking about the MOS device with a very lower value of the channel length, I mean, if the channel length L is small, then obviously you cannot neglect the impact of the channel length modulation. So therefore, instead of writing simply half mu n cox W L 1 VGS1 minus VTH1 whole square, you should incorporate the corresponding 1 plus lambda VDS term. So I am not once again writing down the same expression. Rather, what I can do is I can just show you that this I reference, let me just redefine the last expression, I out upon I reference. So that was, we have already computed like W by L2 by W by L1. That is fine. Now, apart from that, you do have another term, and that term is equal to 1 plus lambda VDS2, which is coming because of channel length modulation. Lambda VDS2 divided by 1 plus lambda VDS1. So, because in this expression you have half mu n C of WL1, VGS1 minus VTH1 whole square multiplied with 1 plus lambda VDS1, and here you have multiplied with 1 plus lambda VDS2. So now you see that depending upon the drain to source potential between these two transistors, because if you just carefully look these two MOS, M1 and M2, obviously their source are connected to ground, fine, but their drains are not connected together. So this potential is something and this potential is something different. So you cannot ensure that VDS2 is equal to VDS1. So as long as VDS2 is not equal to VDS1, then obviously you cannot say that I out is simply a function of I difference, or it's a, I mean, a linear function of I difference. You cannot write like I out is some constant multiplied with I difference that you have done over there. So this simplified circuit which we have started with, so that simplification has to be modified to some extent, because we have seen that this VDS2 and VDS1, they are not the same. What we can observe from this expression also, I mean from this diagram also, the drain to source potential for the first MOS is exactly the same as the gate to source potential. So we can write for the first MOS VDS1 is equal to VGS1, because gate and drain, they are shorted together, and that is also equal to VGS2. So this expression of 1 plus lambda VDS2 by 1 plus lambda VDS1 can also be written like this: VDS1 is nothing but VGS2. So that is also equivalent to, I mean, I can write I out by I reference I out by I reference, that is also equal to, in other way we can write, W by L2 upon W by L1 multiplied with 1 plus lambda VDS2 divided by 1 plus lambda VGS2, because VDS1 is equal to VGS2. But for the second MOS, the drain and gate, they are not shorted together, and we cannot imply this one because we don't know what about the second circuit. So we have to come up with some generic solution which will give you I out is equal to I reference without any further constraint, without any other constraint. So we have to modify this circuit. So now let me just show the modification in the form of cascoding, and then you can appreciate what is the use of having cascoding operation or cascode structure over there. So let me just start with the diagram first. So this is the part of the copying circuit. Gate and drain shorted together, and we do have this MOS whose source is grounded. As I've told that, let us put a common gate stage over there, and then you understand what is the implication of having this common gate stage over there. So since it's common gate, so this potential can be anything. So let me call this potential like V of say X, and this is another point. So let me call this point as point P, and suppose the current that is flowing over here, let me call this current as I out, and this current as I reference. This is the supply line VDD. Let me call this MOS as M1, this MOS as say M2, and say this mass as M3. Let me call the different terminals. Let me call this terminal as say terminal A, and say this terminal to be say terminal B. Now, what is the implication of having a common gate stage over a common source? So, in fact, this combination, this structure itself, is nothing but a cascode structure. Now, what is the implication of having a cascode structure over here? So, to understand the implication, first of all, let me go back to the previous slide. What we want to achieve? We should want that this VDS2 and VGS2, the drain to source potential and the gate to source potential, must be same. Under this condition only, you can expect that I out can be written like some constant multiplied with I reference. So even if I consider W by L2 and W by L1, these two ratios are same, then I can simply write I out is equal to I reference when VDS2 is equal to VGS2. That means this potential, this gate potential, and the drain potential of M2 must be same, because the source is grounded. So gate potential of MOS2 and the drain potential must be same. But last time, we don't have any control about this particular potential, because I don't know from where it is coming, what is the source of this particular point. But now, what we have done, we have added one common gate stage, and having a common gate stage over here, this cascode configuration, this M2, M3 cascode configuration, it will protect this particular potential, the potential at this particular point, to vary because of some external perturbations. What I mean to say is that whenever I connect a common gate stage on the top of this common source, then even if this potential varies, this potential at point P varies, you'll find that this potential at point B will be remaining to a particular value without much fluctuation. So that we can prove just by drawing the corresponding small signal equivalent circuit for the cascode configuration. But before that, you have to ensure the condition for which this current mirror will be acting as a current mirror, proper current mirror, and in which case the corresponding I out is properly defined. The condition is that this gate potential of MOS2 must be equal to the drain potential of the MOS2. Then only this ratio, this 1 plus lambda VGS2 upon 1 plus lambda VGS2, is equal to 1. So the condition is that the potential at point A and the potential at point B must be same, because this gate and drain is connected for MOS1. So the condition is that VA must be equal to VB. And you have to ensure that VB must not vary with the corresponding variation at point B. So that's why we have connected one common gate stage on the above of the common source stage. Now, how to achieve this one? Now, for this, let me just quickly show you the small signal equivalent circuit of a simple common gate, common source cascade. So we have a circuit like this, for example. So this is a common source. Common gate kind of cascade. And suppose there is certain fluctuation at this point. So let me call this point as let me call this point as point P and this point as point B. And let us assume that there is certain fluctuation in the potential at point P, that you can write like delta VP. And let us try to have the corresponding fluctuation at point B, corresponding voltage fluctuation at point B. So for that, we need to draw the corresponding small signal equivalent circuit. So let me call this as MOS M1, this as MOS M2, or better, let me give the same name, M2 and M3. Otherwise, it can create some confusion. So M2 and M3. So looking at this particular point, from this point to this point, from B to P, so this is nothing but the drain to source. So between drain to source, we do have the output resistance RO because of the MOS3, that is M3. So therefore, between these two points, P and B, we do have this resistance. So if I call this point as point P, so that resistance is RO3. And from this point to this point, so this is a common source stage. And obviously, this is operated under saturation region. So let me call the corresponding resistance. So if I just call this resistance, let me call this resistance as, say, resulting from M2, so let me call like RM2. And what about from B to this point? Because as you understand, this point is at AC ground, because since we're talking about the common gate stage, so therefore this point should be at AC ground. So there is no AC signal fluctuation. So what about the corresponding variation? I mean, if I just call, if I just consider these two potential at this point and potential at that point. So this is AC ground. So what about the resistance that is acting between these two points? This is nothing but 1 upon GM plus GMB. So we need to consider the corresponding GMB part, because the source of MOS3 is not grounded. So we need to consider the corresponding body effect. So therefore, the resistance that is present between this point B and the ground is 1 upon GM plus GM, GM plus GMB. So since it is for MOS3, so I can write like GM3 upon GMB3. Then we are interested in finding out the corresponding fluctuation over here. So let me call so this one is delta VB. So because of the fluctuation at this point, voltage fluctuation, whatever the fluctuation you are experiencing at this particular point. So it's a simple voltage divider law. You can write like, you have between these two points, you have the parallel combination of these two resistance, 1 upon GM3 plus GMB3, in shunt with RM2. And so let me just calculate the value. So the value is like RM2 upon GM3 plus GMB3. Divided by RM2 plus 1 by GM3 plus GMB3. So this will give you, if I just multiply with GM3 plus GMB3, then ultimately you have RM2 upon 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3. Into RM2. So then this delta VP and delta VB, so they are related like delta VB. If I call this resistance, this entire resistance as R effective, so then delta VB, the corresponding fluctuation over here, is nothing but delta VP multiplied with R effective, divided by R effective plus RO3. And then if you do some approximation over here, and after calculation, you'll find that this delta VB can be written like, okay, I think I can complete the calculation. So then I have to go to the next slide. That is one of the applications of this Cascode configuration, that it will protect the lower MOS from having the variation at its drain potential. So this delta VB is equal to delta VP, and then you have R effective upon R effective plus RO3. So that is equal to delta VP. Now R effective we have already calculated. That is equal to RM2 upon 1 plus CM. Yes. So R effective is like RM2 divided by 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3 into RM2 divided by, you have this part RM2 upon 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3 into RM2 plus RO3. So then you have delta VP over here, and if you just multiply numerator and denominator with this part, then in the numerator you have RM2 obviously, and in the denominator you have RM2 plus RO3 plus GM3 plus GMB3 times RM2 into RO3. So with this, you can just approximate this expression, and with approximation, what you can find is delta VB, that is approximately equal to 1 upon GM3 plus GMB3 times is RO3. If you just ignore this RM2 in the numerator, in the denominator, assuming that this part, this GMRO component is much, much larger with respect to this RM2, then you can neglect RM2 in the numerator, in the denominator. And then you have this RO3 plus this part. Then what you can do is, you can find out the corresponding approximated value. I mean, so I have another part over here, so it should be multiplied with delta VB. So delta VB is approximated to delta VP upon GM3 plus GMB3 times RO3. Now, assuming that this part is much, much larger, GM3 plus GMB3 times RO3, since it is much, much larger with respect to the other resistance considered over here, so therefore, with a certain fluctuation in delta VP, certain fluctuation at point P, the corresponding fluctuation at point P gets restricted. So that is the main reason because of which we have connected this common gate stage on the top of this common source stage to have the impact of a cascode kind of connection, so that once again, let me go back to the previous diagram. So that even if there is some fluctuation at point P, this point B is held at a constant potential because the corresponding fluctuation gets reduced by a factor of GM3 plus GMB3 multiplied with RO3. So I can assume that this potential at point B can be held constant. And if by some means we can make it equal to V of A, then obviously the drain to source potential of MOS2 is equal to the gate to source potential of the MOS2. Then even if after considering the channel length modulation, this I out can be made equal to I difference, assuming that this W by L ratio being the same for M1 and M2. So that was the concept, that was the reason behind considering this cascode time of configuration over here. Now, I think I need to redraw the circuit once again to explain further. So let me just redraw it once again. So this is a part of the copying circuit. This is iReference, PDD supply. On the top of this common source, you will have a common gate. And let me call this point as point P with the corresponding current that is flowing through it is I out. So this point is point B and this point is point A. So let me call the MOS M1, M2, and M3. Now since it is common gate, then obviously there should be a particular potential VB, because ultimately you have to ensure that all these three transistors M1, M2, M3, they are in saturation. Otherwise the notion of the current mirror will not be possible. So therefore all these three transistors M1, M2, M3 must be in saturation, and let us assume that the potential that you are applying at the gate of this MOS 3 is equal to VB, for example. So now the thing is that you have to ensure VA, I think it will be better, anyway, let me just have like VB. So you have to ensure that V of A, I think, yes, it will be better if I call it like V3. So the condition is that VA, capital V capital A, must be equal to V capital B, so that the drain to source potential of MOS 2 is equal to the gate to source potential of MOS 2. Now, what about this V3? What about the gate potential of this MOS M3? So this is connected with VA and VB. How is it connected? You see, this potential minus the gate to source potential is equal, gate to source potential of MOS 3 is equal to the potential at point B. So you can write V3 minus VGS3 must be equal to VB, and that is also equal to VA. So we can write V3 is equal to VGS3 plus VA. So accordingly, you have to provide the corresponding voltage at the gate of MOS 3. The condition is that already you've got like VA over here. So this VA plus some gate to source drop of a MOS is equal to the corresponding potential at the gate of MOS 3. So therefore, over and above this MOS M1, we can connect another MOS so that this drop of gate to source voltage, when added with the potential at point A, will give you the gate potential at MOS 3. So let me clarify. Show you the circuit first, because already the equation says that V3, the gate potential, must be equal to the gate to source potential of MOS 3 plus VA. So there is a gate to source potential difference between VA and V3. So that you have to provide over here. So now, over here, you will have this one. Over here, you have this MOS, like M1. And for which the gate and drain, they are connected together. And this potential is equal to VA. Now, apart from that, you must be having another MOS on the top of it. So then this potential, so that was point A. So these potentials, if I call this as say MOS 4, this was MOS 1. So then this potential, which is at the gate of MOS 4, is nothing but V of A plus VGS4. Now this potential, if it is provided to the input of this MOS, that is M3, then it can satisfy the corresponding condition. Obviously, there is one pause which I want to mention over here, that VGS3 must be equal to VGS4. So I'm coming to that. So before that, let me just complete the circuit. So this is for MOS 2. So this VB, this potential, so this one is I out, and this is the reference current, that is I reference. So let me call this as M2, this as M3. This is point B, this is point A, and this potential is equal to V3. So now what you can find from one side, you will see that this V3 is equal to VGS3 plus VB. If I go from this way, so V3 is equal to this gate to source drop plus the potential over here. So you can write V3 is equal to VGS3 plus VB. And if you go from this side, then you find that V3 is equal to VGS4 plus VA. Now both of them are same because they are referring to the same potential. So therefore VGS3 plus VB is equal to VGS4 plus VA. Now what we are aiming at? We are aiming at providing VA is equal to VB, because only under this condition the impact of channel length modulation can be eliminated from the expression. So our requirement is VA equal to VB, so we have to ensure VGS3 must be equal to VGS4. So that we have to ensure. We need to ensure, because this is not automatically given. This gate to source potential, the difference of voltage between this point, between these two points, between this node, this, if I call this node as node 3, so between 3 and B and 3 and A, if I call, if they are same, then only these two potentials will be the same, otherwise not. So how to ensure that VGS3 is equal to VGS4? Then once again, you have to consider the corresponding current expression under saturation region. Then we do have this W by L ratio of this MOS, M4, M3, M1 and M2. And there are certain condition which has to be followed. Then you'll see that this VGS3 is equal to VGS4. So if I just write down the expression. So in the left hand side, you have this MOS 1 and MOS 4, M1 and M4. So what you can write like half mu n c ox w by l 1 vgs 1 minus vth 1 whole square is equal to half mu n c ox w by l 4 vgs 4 minus vth 4 whole square. That is coming from the left hand side because they are getting the same current, and here from the right hand side you can write half mu n c ox w by l 2 vgs 2 minus
vth 4
whole square, that is equal to half mu n c ox w by l 3 into vgs 3 minus vth 3 whole square. Now these are the two equations. Now if I just divide them, equation 1 by equation 2, and then what we are getting, this w by l 1 into vgs 1 minus vth 1 whole square divided by w by l 2 vgs 2 minus vth 2 whole square, that is equal to w by l 4 vgs 4 minus vth 4 whole square upon w by l 3 vgs 3 minus vth 3 whole square. Now let me make one assumption that this all the threshold voltage being the same, that means vth 1 equal to vth 2 equal to vth 3 and vth 4, so all of them are same. And moreover, we find that this gate to source voltage of MOS 1 and gate to source voltage of MOS 2 being the same because they are sharing the same gate and their source are connected to ground. So therefore vgs 1 and vgs 2, I mean this ratio, it can be further simplified like w by l 1 upon w by l 2, and that is equal to w by l 4 by w by l 3 multiplied with vgs 4 minus vth, I am just writing whole square, and vgs 3 minus vth whole square. The note is that, let me make the note over here, vth 1 is equal to vth 2 is equal to vth 3 is equal to vth 4, so all of them are sharing the same threshold voltage and that is equal to vth. Now under this condition you find that this is the corresponding scenario. So if I want to have, let me go back to the previous slide. Yeah. Now if I want to have that VGS 3 is equal to VGS 4, if I want to ensure VGS 3 is equal to VGS 4, then the thing is that W by L ratio of this 4 defined MOS must be connected, must be satisfying this condition. The condition is that, let me just write down over here, the condition is that 1 by 2, 4 by 3. Yeah, the condition is that, you know, to ensure this one, if I want to ensure this one, the condition is that W by L, let me just change the orientation, 1 by 2 and 4 by, 1 by 2 and 4 by 3, okay. So the condition is that W by L 1 upon W by L2 if that is made equal to this one. If this is satisfied, the W by L1 upon W by L2 is equal to W by L4 upon W by L3, then we can ensure that VGS equal to VGS, VGS3 equal to VGS4. And then the potential at point A is equal to the potential at point B. And therefore, for MOS2, the gate to source potential is equal to the drain to source potential. And we can find, or we can write, I difference is equal to I out. So we can define I out properly. So I out is properly defined in this case if these conditions are satisfied. Now, while talking about the current source or the notion of current mirror, one thing is obviously the amplitude or the magnitude of the current source, which are copying here is like I reference. So right now we are not bothered about the magnitude, because assuming that we have certain I reference, which you have generated by certain means. And here in current mirror circuit, our objective is to copy that current properly. We have some reference current source, I reference, and current mirror circuit will help you to copy the current from a reference current source to other parts of the circuit properly without the influence of any external perturbations. So that is important. Without the influence of the temperature, without the influence of the corresponding radiation, the threshold voltage, and without the influence of any other terminal voltage. So that is our objective, to copy it properly. And moreover, we should always expect that the output resistance provided by the current source should be as large as possible. But another thing which we must not forget is the corresponding voltage headroom. That means the available swing. We always want that the corresponding swing, which is available to us, should be as high as possible. So from this perspective, let us check what is the comparison between this particular thing, this one, and which we have started earlier. Now let me just compare these two figures, this figure and this figure. So here, so if I just call this as figure number one, so let me call as figure number one, and say this as figure number two, for example. Now here we can arbitrarily put the value of V3. There is no guarantee that V3 is equal to VGS3 plus VA. It cannot track the potential, this gate potential of MOS3 cannot track this particular thing until and unless you go by circuit 2. In circuit 2, it can properly track because of the presence of this MOS. And we have already ensured that VGS3 is equal to VGS4. So therefore, this potential at point A and the potential at point B must be the same. Otherwise, what you can do is you can arbitrarily put some value for V3 over here, and let us try to have VA is equal to VB. But until and unless it satisfies this particular condition, you cannot get VA equal to VB. So for this circuit, if you arbitrarily put the value of V3, if you arbitrarily provide some voltage at the gate of MOS3, then the I out is poorly defined. So you cannot expect that I out is always equal to I reference. Because if this condition is not satisfied, then obviously it will not be equal to I reference. However, for this circuit, for the second circuit, if we find that since it is properly defined, VA is equal to VB always by virtue of the circuit itself, then obviously the second circuit is advantageous as compared to the first one. But now, as far as the voltage headroom is concerned, we can also compare the first circuit with the second circuit. Now, let me start with the second circuit first. Now for the second circuit, if I just call this as point P, suppose this is a point P, then what about the minimum value at point P? What about the minimum potential at point P? So that these two MOS devices, M3 and M2, are in saturation. So that we have to identify. Now, first of all, you must appreciate that if I call this as potential at point P, so in order to make M3 in saturation region, obviously, this VP, so let me go to the next slide. So VP should be greater than or equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. Or in other words, we can say that VP minus VS should be greater than or equal to gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage. VDS should be greater than or equal to the gate to source minus the threshold voltage. So source potential is B. So the condition is VP must be greater than or equal to V3 minus VTH3. So if I write the minimum value for VP, you cannot go beyond this point. So the minimum value is equal to V3 minus VTH. So let me assume that all of them are having same threshold voltage, so V3 minus VTH. Now what about the value for V3? So V3 we can find, already we have written over there. So this is nothing but VGS3 plus VB, or VGS4 plus VA. And what is VA? VA is nothing but VGS1, because it's gate and drain shorted. Therefore, we can write V3 as VGS4 plus VGS1. VGS4 plus VGS1. So that you can write like VGS4 plus VGS1 minus VTH. So that can be written like VGS4 minus VTH plus VGS1 minus VTH plus VTH. So therefore, the minimum voltage at point P, to ensure that this combination is in saturation, is equal to the summation of the two overdrive voltage of MOS3 and MOS1 and MOS4 plus the threshold voltage. So VGS1 minus VTH, so this is the overdrive voltage for MOS1. Overdrive voltage of MOS1 plus the overdrive voltage of MOS4 plus the threshold voltage. So that is the minimum value of the point P. Now, let me go to the first circuit. Now, for the first circuit, what will be the minimum value? And also, what you can write over here, we can also write this as, we can also write like VGS4 is equal to VGS3, because that we have already ensured with proper ratio. Just now we have proved the condition that VGS3 can be made equal to VGS4, and VGS1 is also equal to VGS2, because the gate of 1 and 2, they are connected together. So I can write like VGS2 minus VTH plus VTH. And this will help me to explain the corresponding minimum value at point P for the first circuit. Now for the first circuit, so this is nothing but the drain potential of MOS3. So to ensure that this is in saturation, so what is the condition? The condition is that it should be greater than this overdrive corresponding to this MOS, that is nothing but VGS3 minus VTH, And what about the potential at point B? So for the second circuit, so this is for the second circuit. For second, and for first, we find that VP minimum is equal to VGS 3 minus VGS 3 minus VTH or VTH 3, same thing, plus the potential at point B, that is VB. And what about VB? You know, to ensure that M2 is also in saturation, so VB should be greater than or equal to VGS 2 minus VTH 2. So we can write the minimum value for VB is VGS 2 minus VTH. So it is nothing but VGS 3 minus VTH plus VGS 2 minus VTH. Because VB minimum is equal to VGS 2 minus VTH. So for the first circuit, what we find is the VP minimum is the summation of the two over drive voltage only. However, for the second circuit, we find that the VP minimum is nothing but the summation of the two over drive voltage plus another threshold voltage. So obviously, the second circuit is not advantageous because we always want that the corresponding available swing should be as high as possible. So the minimum value should be as small as possible. So for the first circuit, it is fine, the summation of the two over drive voltage. But for the second circuit, it's nothing but the summation of two over drive voltage plus the additional threshold voltage. So that is one of the disadvantages resulting from the second circuit. However, for the second circuit, we find that this Iout is properly defined. Whereas for the first circuit, Iout is poorly defined. If you keep this potential undefined, potential at gate 3 undefined, without proper relation between this VGS 3 and VGS 4, then obviously this Iout is not properly defined. It is very poorly defined. So our basic notion of having the current mirror gets lost. So from this analysis, what we can understand is that whenever we go for the current mirror circuit, then obviously you should have to optimize between certain parameters. One is how perfectly you are copying the current, how perfect your mirror is, how perfectly you are copying the current from a reference current source. And obviously, the corresponding voltage headroom that is being consumed by the MOS devices. Because as you are making the circuit much more perfect, then obviously you are adding so many devices, so many MOS devices into the structure. And as soon as you introduce more number of MOS devices into the structure, the corresponding voltage headroom gets increased, and which will limit the corresponding available fluctuation or swing of the voltage. So there is always a trade-off between these two parameters. One is how perfectly the current source is defined or current source is copied. And second thing is the available voltage swing or voltage headroom. We want that the current source or current mirror should be properly defined, and the voltage headroom should be as less as possible, as small as possible. However, these two parameters are contradictory in nature, because as you are making the circuit much more perfect, you're introducing more number of device, and which will eventually increase the corresponding voltage headroom. So there is a trade-off, and ultimately we have to come up with a certain solution which will give us the best possible way, which can optimize, which can trade off both of these two parameters simultaneously. Now with this, let me conclude my today's introductory discussion on current mirror circuit.